The Old School Rewind Podcast. Get on with the show. The podcast about breakdance music.
So why is it got to be so damn tough?
Hip hop and old school. The roots of electronic music. The Roland 808 and freestyle. This is the Old School Rewind with Randy Bubba Black on the Podcaster Online Network, Facebook.com. Search Old School Rewind and subscribe now at iTunes with all links at oldschoolrewind.com.
Randy Bubba Black back again with the Old School Rewind, the artist and the songs. It's Kurtis Blow on this week's show. After a moment of silence for Las Vegas.
You say a one for the trouble, two for the time. Come on, y'all, let's...
Hello there from Randy Bubba Black. Hope you've subscribed. Hope you've shared. I hope you've reviewed at iTunes. It's all a huge help in the streaming game, and especially playing this old school music. We're still trying to be new and noteworthy, and we're up on our seventh episode. So enjoy. Kurtis Blow.
Crush grooving, body moving.
I'm Kurtis Blow, I'm the king and I'm the best, y'all. And I'll tell you why, cause I'm fresh, y'all. From the north to south, east to west, y'all. Now I rock house parties in the B-boys dance. And never ever gave a sucker MC a chance. Cause I'm a rhyme creator, crowd motivator. I'm chilling on you now, but I can serve you later. Check out my crew that could never be beat. A
Kurtis Blow, Sheila E, and Run DMC. And to the Fat Boys.
Fat Boys.
So my favorite part is to the Fat Boys. You know, you're down by law. Kurtis Blow.
Down by law.
Kurtis Blow, the first hip-hop superstar, the first solo hip-hop artist to make it on wax. First gold record. Anything I'm missing a first on, Kurtis?
No, you're right on, right on. Thank you for the awesome, incredible introduction, my friend.
My beatbox isn't on point, so that's the best I can do, man.
No. You're right on, right on.
I'm an old hip-hop kid. Did you think, I ask everybody when I open the show, sometimes I wait a couple questions to get in, but right now, I'm getting to be 49 years old, white boy on the West Coast. Did you think, when you were cutting those records, you were playing out to the West Coast, or did you think your stuff was going to be regional, or did you have the foresight to know that it was going to go big and the guys like me were going to hear it eventually?
No, actually, in those early days, we all knew that we all had the potential to go national. That's what it was all about, you know, especially with the success of the Sugar Hill Gang and Rappers Alike, 1979 in summer, it was on. You know, everybody knew it was like an explosion. I'm talking about every car, train, bus, cab, taxi cab, people with boom boxes, speakers outside the window, all around the country. Everybody's playing this Rapper's Delight song. So we just followed suit and got successful. And it was pretty easy after that, as a matter of fact.
When you put those songs out, the early songs, now, and I'm talking, let's...
Don't you give me all that jive about things you wrote before I was alive. Cause this ain't 1823, ain't even 1970. Now I'm the guy named Kurtis Blow.
The Christmas rap.
Christmas rapping, and then if someone recut that in the 90s, I can hit, that's a...
Yes, next, with the song called Too Close.
Is that paying you well these days, that particular song?
Yeah, an incredible payday. They hit hard. I think they went double platinum or triple platinum with that song. It was the number one song. Billboard's the number one song of the year. I think it was 92 or something like that. But yeah, big shout out to the group Nex, man. Nice guys, too. Incredible. Baby, don't you like it? Nice song. A lot of sin in that song, but a good song.
You know, and it's still spinning and recurrent on these what they're calling classic stations. Now, it's one of the reasons that I started doing the podcast is because they're calling classic year 2000 now. And then they're calling the 90s. You know, the 90s are even classic. Well, no, classic to me is going to be Cold Crush.
I'm fresh because I'm the best. And I get wild when I'm wild.
I never get passed by because I'm fine.
And I'm going to put you on hold because I'm bold.
And Charlie Chase will last because he's last. And Tony Tone got pulled because he's original.
Going to be Love Bug, going to be Cool Herc, you.
Of course, yeah, the 80s, yeah. But then, you know, nowadays, you can look at the 90s, and you go, oh, man, those are OG Dr. Dre tracks.
I know.
I mean, incredible stuff. That was some incredible boom bap rap in the 90s, too. So, yeah, they're cool.
Hey, was the Bronx mad at Rapper's Delight when it came out?
Did it hit? Hit me to the hip, hip hop, you don't stop the rockin' to the bang, bang, boogie, say up, jump the boogie to the rhythm of the boogie to beat.
Sort of, that was the consensus. A lot of cats did not feel good about the Rapper's Delight song from the Bronx because they felt, you know, they're from the Bronx and they should have been the first initial groups or solo artists to be successful with the records, because they were from the Bronx. But, you know, hey, God created hip-hop, and a lot of cats out of the Bronx got the opportunity to make records because of that Sugar Hill Gang. So, you know, I think back now and sort of like, you know, being from Harlem and growing up in Queens and stuff like that, I was sort of like a little bit of that Sugar Hill stigma myself, you know, being... I wasn't from the Bronx, but as we all got older and we started hanging out and touring together and they were accepted later on and we all owe them a great debt. The Sugar Hill Gang, Joe Robinson Sr., Joe Robinson Jr., rest in peace, Sylvia Robinson, rest in peace. Man, it's a great family, the first family of hip hop.
That venom back in the day, they wouldn't call it beef. That was before beef. They didn't call it beef. What do we call it back then? It's just nothing. You just knew somebody was around the way was ticked, I guess.
Yeah. It's early beef. We had beef in the 80s, too. But guys are like, you know, it's really serious now. You know, they're violent. And
That R&B flavor turned into a dance freestyle movement. And then, you know, peripherated the radio, and then all of a sudden we had it. But it took a while to get there, and then it took that horrible right turn. What did you think when you heard Dr. Dre on the radio for the first time and gangster music being mass appeal? Because I'm sure that you had an NWA tape or you had heard, you know, Ice-T shit. I mean, everybody had. But how about once it started getting on the radio? Did you think, what have I done? Because I think that some of the time I think of that, what have I done? Because I was so hip to play, I was just so hip to promote hip hop, and then it turned gangster, and then where do you think it lies?
Well, you know, I have some real bad feelings about those days because. You know, I became like a hater and I wasn't a fan and I spoke out on it publicly.
Oh, okay.
And then I started to read those interviews, right?
And it looks like a hater.
Oh my God. I was like hating myself. You know what I mean? Like, gosh,
sure.
You know, we're all supposed to treat people like we want to be treated. So I don't want people to actually just judge my music and say, you know, because on the other hand, you could say this about my music and I'm saying that about yours. And that's not why we got into the business in the first place. We all want to just, you know, be entertainers and at the same time get paid for it. You know, that's smart. But you know, it's all about entertainment and the joy and the love and the fun and just making people happy, you know. And so I started to shut my mouth and I regret those days when I spoke out because it wasn't right. You know, we're not supposed to judge. And, you know, I make the music that I make and I'm happy and you know, I see the good in everyone. And that's the great thing about my big change into Christianity and finding God in my life is I had to change that tune right quick.
So wait a second.
Amen.
You went to college and studied religion. Yes. So you're not just finding religion now in the current. It's always been a part of your.
No. No. I went to college in the 70s with Russell Simmons, and I was a communications major, speech broadcasting. Now, when I became a Christian, when I got saved and became born again, that was in 1994. So I went back to college about 5 years later, right before 2000. Yeah, I was in New York.
Oh, okay.
When 2011 hit.
So it's a little bit
so,
later.
I mean, 9/11 hit. So that was 2000. I was in school.
So you went back. You went back to learn.
I went back.
Religion now in the current. It's always been a part of your.
No. I went to college in the 70s with Russell Simmons, and I was a communications major, speech broadcasting. Now, when I became a Christian, when I got saved and became born again. That was in 1994. So I went back to college, about 5 years later, right before 2000. Yeah, I was in New York.
Oh, okay.
When 2011 hit.
So it's a little bit
so,
later.
I mean, 9/11 hit. So that was 2000. I was in school.
So you went back. You went back to learn.
I went back to major in theology and gotcha. And pastoral ministries. And I had a minor of urban ministries, no doubt.
To find that's even a course. That's funny to even hear that's a class you can take.
Check it out. That's the hip-hop church right there, urban ministry. Amen.
Amen.
On the bandstand. Bandstand.
You are extraordinary. Now, do you mean to tell me, when you travel to England, do they understand this typically American sound?
Oh, really, really. Even more so than England, where they do speak English, like places like Germany, for instance, where there is a language barrier.
Can you rap in German?
Well, there are German rappers. I can't rap in German, but there are rappers who speak in German and who rap in the German language, and they understand it, and they love it over there.
Is that your, I forgot where they said it. Is that your fifth album?
No, it's my sixth album.
Sixth. Well, I miscounted all. Are you going to make more movies after Crush Crew?
Yeah. Right now, I'm pursuing an acting career, and I'm looking for new movie roles. I've got a couple of offers, but I'm not really satisfied on what I've gotten, so I'm still searching.
Do you enjoy producing other people now, or do you feel that maybe you should be in there doing it yourself?
Oh, no. I find a lot of fun, and I get a lot of motivation and influence out of the young rappers who are coming up now that I have helped.
Young rappers that are coming up now. The grand old man. Come on now.
Oh, I'm about 10 years older than some of the young guys that are coming out now. You know, they're 15, 16. I'm 25, you know. So, like, hey.
The grand old man of rap. Kurtis, thank you so much. Kurtis Blow, ladies and gentlemen, let's go with this.
I want to know about Mama and Daddy Blow and how they came up with that last name, Blow. Because I understand there were 27 definitions of Blow in the dictionary. So how'd your mom and dad come up with your last name, Kurtis?
Well, no, actually, my name is Walker.
Yeah, I know.
That became a term in college, just messing around with the old college crowd, Russell Simmons and the crew. And they wanted me to be like the protege of another well-known MC during that time. His name is Eddie Cheever, and I was like, oh, no way. I'm cool DJ Kurt. You need to change your... What do you want me to change my name? I was like joking with him, like, what do you want me to be? Kurtis Blow or somebody? Cheever and Blow? I'm like... And they all started laughing. No, that's a great idea. That's a great idea. You're Kurtis Blow. You're Kurtis... I said, no, I'm not. I'm DJ Kurt Walker, the show enough talker. So I got back, we got back to the school next week, and names spread around the college like wildfire, and I just couldn't get over. So one day I was looking in the dictionary, let me look, and I saw there were 28 different meanings for the word blow, and all these different connotations and means, like, I mean, you got everything in there from sex, drugs, and music. It's there. You have, you know, the force of power, communications. This is how you blow air out of your mouth and mix with your vocal cords is how we communicate. And it's the big thing about music, that cat can blow. That, or to blow means to be successful. He's blowing up. Or I'm going to blow you up. He's blowing up like a neutron bomb. Or literally, I'm going to blow you up.
That's a fit.
But I'm going to blow you away. You know, blowtorch, blowfish, blowpipe. I mean, oh my gosh. I was like, but you know, the real reason why I did it is because there was one meaning that means to fertilize or to blossom, right?
Sure.
Another connotation of being successful is to blossom, but that is the factuality of life. Is when a flower spits pollen out, it blows. Have you ever seen that slow motion thing?
I have.
And all the pollen, yeah, that explosion. It's an orgasm.
Hey, man, there's a mind. There is a whole, when I heard that, and I heard you, I think I heard you talking to Sway. Sway's from out this way and part of the movement back then before he went up there to the satellite in New York and all that. But I heard you say, you started in about the words and stuff and the flower blowing. And I'm like, man, this is deep, man. This is a lot deeper than anybody would ever think, man.
It's life. It's life. And here's the kicker. Now, the first time I ever did any kind of entertainment, and I just remembered this about 6 weeks. You know how things go deep in your subconscious mind, and then you relive it and think about it later on in life. Here I am, 58 years old, and I'm going back to elementary, kindergarten. The first play in kindergarten, I played this Egyptian god named Osiris. I don't know if you know the story about him getting fooled by his brother Set, and put him in a coffin, and he nailed the coffin shut and chopped him up and sent them down the Nile. And his wife, Isis, made a wooden phallus and gave it to him and cast a spell on him, brought him back to life. And he became the god of fertilization because they created a child that night. And his name was Horus. Horus grew up to become, he got the revenge and killed Set. So you saw the gods of Egypt. That's Horus. But Osiris was killed by Set. That's the real story. And so I'm in this coffin at 5 years old, and I'm Osiris. And Osiris is the god of rehabilitation, and he's the god of fertilization. Because when he went down the Nile, he fertilized the whole Nile, and that's when the creation of life. So he's the god of the creation of life, fertilization, the god of the night and day, and that's where we get the phallus.
It's an incredible story.
So that's me. I played Osiris. I'm the god of reincarnation. I'm reincarnated.
Tell me, death has put an end to a lot of the feuds and beefs over the year. Maybe you got a couple of those beefs you could talk about with me, and how grateful you are to still be alive from selling PCP in high school. Just too many out. There's not too many people that are still out there that had that type of lifestyle and then turned it and are still here today.
Well, if you really think about it, life is a bunch of decisions one after another, and depending upon the decisions you make during the course of your life will determine whether or not you will survive. I would like to think that religion gives us a better chance of survival within this life that we live. If we just follow the
faces
rules
and faces, you know,
of Christianity or any religion in that matter. I think we're successful, more successful. We have an advantage over everybody else who's unchurched. But basically, hey, it is what it is. I didn't sell PCP in high school. I sold marijuana.
Gotcha. Sorry. Uncle Rush was selling fake stuff. Were you selling the real stuff or what? Was this a sham you guys came up with, or you're not together at this point?
Never said. That was college, and gotcha. That was a scam he came up with.
Lucky to be alive.
Yeah. That was pretty dangerous. You know, during those days, you know, those decisions that we made, we were fortunate enough to not pay the price.
Right.
And as a matter of fact, you know, as a drug dealer, you get to see people change right before your eyes.
Especially in an urban area like that, where you're from.
Yeah.
It's a little different. Out here, it's a little different because it's open air and there's no skyscraper. You know, drug dealing's not really the corner thing. I mean, it is, but it's not like in a very urban area with vaulted buildings all around. You know, it has to be a different thing, and you got to see the same people every day.
Yeah, but that was the deterrent for me, just to see how you were actually, you know, causing death in the community and seeing people deteriorate right before your eyes. I couldn't sleep with that, so.
Good.
That was not a long-lasting endeavor for me. As Good. A matter of fact, I became against drugs, totally against drugs, when I became famous a couple of years later, being the first, the national spokesman, the first to say no to drugs.
Oh, Reagan, I gotcha.
That was my voice. Say no to drugs and say yes to your life. And working with Nancy Reagan, rest in peace.
Was she a nice lady?
Oh, very nice. Very, very, very nice. Very nice lady.
That's the first time yes. anybody's dropped Nancy Reagan's name on the Old School Rewind, just so you know, Kurt. That's deep.
Oh, man.
Hey, that's deep,
yeah, man.
Yeah,
man. Yes, yes.
Hey, you got a million-dollar smile, Kurt. What I want to know is, do you have good teeth or a good dentist?
Because
you show them pearlies. Them pearlies have been showing for a long time, and not a lot of rappers were happy when they were performing or smiling like you smiled when you were performing. You got a good dentist or you got good genetics?
Well, you know, we have to do what we have to do to
a good dentist
to be successful within this world. Man, I did everything I wanted to do in my lifetime to become a star. That's what I wanted to be. I wanted to be popular and famous, and I wanted to get all the girls.
Great shape, always took off your shirt, opened up a jacket. That was a thing for you, right?
Well, in my younger days, yeah, that was, you know, sports, staying healthy. Yeah, I used to run a lot. A lot of people don't know that. I used to run. You know, I used to box. I used to play football. I was an athlete, very, very good athlete. And that's why I still can hold down the court now. Amen.
Amen. Preach, Curtis, preach. Hey, the parties in the park, I thought this was interesting, too. Like I said, I did a bunch of work on it. I'm a fan, so all I know is what a fan knows who was a DJ, which means I was spread thin. I had so much to learn about. I was still trying to learn how to mix and whatnot. So I'm going back, and I'm relearning the history that I didn't even know in the first place that I might have learned on the way, you know, on my way to 50 years old, which is where I'm at now. I heard you talk on an interview about people making the jump. And you said there were plenty of people that were great, but they just couldn't make the jump. So now they're still that neighborhood. They're that neighborhood story. Well, yeah, man, Kurtis blows great, but did you ever hear DJ, you know, whatever? and, you know, that guy's still in the hood, never wanted to, or still in the neighborhood, and didn't want to make the jump, but was a talented guy. Is there anybody that sticks to your mind that would have been one of those people or would have been right next to you on the way up if they had just, quote-unquote, your words, made the jump?
No, I don't want to just say names like that, but I would love to give a shout-out. I would love to give a shout-out to a lot of guys who actually were DJing and rapping and b-boying before the records came out. People like the Fantastic Five and the Funky Four and the Cold Crush Brothers and the of course the Furious and the Treacherous Three and the Fearless Four,
Crash Crew,
cats like that. There were a lot of cats around, you know, groups and solo artists that never got the acknowledgement. You know, rest in peace to Donald D and B-Fats and people like Timmy Hall and Rocky Buchano, the Come Off Crew, Johnny G, Eddie Cheever, Love Bug Starsky, a big name, big, huge name, who's supposed to be right next to me. My good friend, shout out to him. He's out in Vegas. He's safe.
Well, hello, everybody. How you been? It's Starsky, and I'm back again with a true, true story to tell you all. And if you listen to me, you're going to have a ball. First, you die with the dip, dips with the dive. Clean out your ears and you open your eyes, because I'm the L-O-V-E-B-U-G. Rocking in the rhythm and the harmony. See, I'm stuck with the bug. I like to be hugged, and that's why the ladies call me the love. On and on, at the fever, until the break of dawn, yeah, shit, y'all, I keep going strong, at the fever, right where it belongs, put your hand on your hip, and let your back won't slip, the metal on the pedal, the heat in the beat, cause the people in the back get nice to whack, whack, the people in the front, let's do the bump, bump, the people on the side, hey, take a ride, the people in the middle, let me see you wiggle, all together now, on time, y'all, just look in the sky, look in the trees, who do you see,
Yeah, and
shout out to Vegas. This is a podcast. You're not really supposed to time yourself or locate yourself, but shout out to Vegas. We are.
Yeah, all the families. Amen.
The discos were cool, and that's where everything was happening, but you had to pay to get in, and some people couldn't pay to get in or didn't want to pay to get in, and that's sort of where the inception of the Party in the Parks came from. Is that true?
Yes, of course. Yeah, the younger kids could not, you know, get into the clubs. They were not old enough. And of course, you know, you had some people who didn't have money to pay to get in. So, the park jams and the block parties started because of that right there. And then you had, you know, the older cats who just weren't going, the family, the moms, the grandmothers, they would love to do the cookouts and bring the grills outside and cook food for everybody while the DJ would play music. And it was just a get together for the block at the end of the summer, just to show solidarity. And the DJ became the most important thing because he had the music and it was loud. And the next thing was the food.
Hear me? Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The get down part of each of the older rap songs had that big beat. And Doc Ice talked about Billy Squire's big beat in Roxanne, Roxanne. What, while you were playing around with mom and dad's records and digging, what record got you excited at that time, maybe spinning, and you thought, wow, this is cool, mom and dad's party or get together and you're digging around being the DJ in the house. Was there one song that vibed you? You created the vibe for me. What created the vibe for you?
It was always James Brown. He was my hero. Jimmy Castor.
Mm-hmm. guess he would be second, my hero. I wanted to be like Jimmy Casser and get that big afro. He lived 1 mile north, exactly north. I was at 465 West 140th Street. And he was 465 West 160th Street, 1 mile north. He went to the High School of Music and Art, so did I. And he loved timbales, and so do I. I know how to play timbali.
I'm not going to play smart now. What's that? Sorry.
Oh, timbali? Timbales are like a drum instrument. It's an instrument. It's a drum.
Okay, gotcha.
But it's sort of like mid-range to high, you know.
Okay.
It's really Latin for...
You got to remember, man, out here in California, man, it's very homogenized. There wasn't, we didn't have that Puerto Rican culture. We have Hispanic culture here, but we didn't have that Puerto Rican culture. And I think that Puerto Rican culture is a little more vibrant.
Yeah, salsa music has a predominant instrument in salsa. It's the timbales, for sure. And funk, and old school funk. Jimmy Castor, definitely, yes. Ray Barretto, people like that.
Let's see here. What did I want to ask you? Oh, music spawned breakdancing. Can you narrow down the songs that actually started breakdancing in your world? Which were the songs that started it? Or is it too wide of a...
You know, those songs, a guy is writing a book right now about those songs. And everybody wants to know those songs nowadays.
Oh, then let's not talk about it. Let's wait for the book to come out.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's some... Jimmy Cash isn't in James Brown, I'll tell you that much.
You talk about the Eastern Parkway on an interview I saw from you. How it was lit up with DJs. Tell me about that time.
Well, you have to know the two different worlds of hip-hop. You have the underground, the younger kids, the guys who didn't have money who went to the block parties and the gyms and the park jams and all those cats and that crowd from Kool Herc to Flash to, you know, the Funky Four and blah, blah. And then you had another side, which were a little older crowd who wore shoes and suits and ties and silk dresses and went to the clubs and worked all week and paid their $5-$10 to get into the club down in Midtown Manhattan or downtown. And that crowd basically was the disco crowd playing music like, you know, YMCA and Donna Summers and Patrick Jovay and all of that stuff. We all know disco. And so Eastern Parkway had the biggest group of those kind of DJs, those disco street DJs, who would come out every summer on Eastern Parkway to the festival. They had the Caribbean Street Festival on Eastern Parkway every year. And this is where you got loads and loads of DJs that set up all up and down Eastern Parkway. And, oh, man. Flowers, McBoyer, Pete DJ Jones, Ripping Cliff Plummer. These were the disco street DJs who frequented the clubs like Nemo's and Nell Gwynn's and Pippin's and stuff like that, clubs like that. So that crowd, and these were Caribbean DJs as well. And so, like Flowers, Grandmaster Flowers, so word on the street is that a lot of DJs from England, or let's say Jamaica, who were doing toasting and ragamuffin, came to Eastern Parkway because it was a Caribbean fest. And then you had that kind of fusion between the DJ, the disco DJs and these Caribbean DJs. With toasting, and that's where you got the MC from. I heard word on the street is a part of hip hop came from that Eastern Parkway set.
Hey, what's a Bronx Was Burning mean to you? And how does that sort of play into the starts of hip-hop?
Did you say the street names?
Bronx Was Burning. Bronx Was Burning. What did that mean to you? I mean, that was one of the original graffiti. I heard you talk about graffiti and how, you know, the culture sort of stems from graffiti. But Bronx Was Burning. Graffiti wasn't a tag thing. It was more of a socio-political thing where people were, you know, there was a fire in the Bronx and Bronx was burning. And that was tell me about the correlation between graffiti and that.
Yeah, well, it's all in the culture, part of the culture, and just oppression and just coming out of civil rights and the civil rights movement and the kids up in the Bronx and Harlem who were poor kids in the ghetto, didn't have anything really, really to do. And so there's a lot of poverty. And New York all of a sudden went bankrupt. So you had a lot of landlords up in the South Bronx and the Bronx who couldn't get people to move into their building. So what they did was they burned them down, and it became a scam collecting the insurance money.
And so
a lot of people stayed in those buildings and lived rent-free when the electricity wasn't turned off, and put speakers outside the windows, and we listened to music all night in these abandoned buildings. They became the clubhouses for a lot of gangs as well.
What's the time frame of all this time? But when is this happening?
Yeah, this is between 72-73 to 78, about 5 year period.
I'm not hip to it. Sheltered in the West Coast. Here's what I knew about New York: Son of Sam was loose and the power was out. That's about all I got.
Exactly. Same time. Blackout of 77. Yeah. It was devastation, really. And then you had, you know, of course, you had the drug wars of Frank Lucas, that whole
sure,
crew.
The heroin thing.
Yeah, and the gangs.
How do you turn from going DJ to a rapper to the almighty Kurtis Blow, king of hip-hop?
Well,
when do you pick up a mic? Or were you picking up the mic while you were DJing?
Well, for me, at first I was a B-boy, and then I became a DJ.
Gotcha. Because
the DJs weren't playing the right music to B-boy to.
Sure.
I got the chance to rap in 1974. And that was a special time. Yeah, I was a young kid in high school, music and arts, high school.
Let's run through some songs real quick.
They're playing basketball. We love that basketball. 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 They're playing basketball. We love that
now
basketball.
Rapping basketball, number one, Kurtis Blow.
Basketball is my favorite sport. I like the way to dribble up and down the court. Just like I'm the king on the microphone. So is Dr. J and Moses Malone. I like slam dunks and taking it to the hoop. My favorite play is the alley-oop. I like the pick and roll. I like the give and go. Cause it's basketball of Mr. Kurtis Blow.
Basketball. Who was your favorite team?
Well, New York Knicks were my favorite basketball team, you know, growing up in New York. And my stepdad was a big sports fan. As a matter of fact, I'm a sports fanatic because of him. And as early as I can remember, 2 and 3 years old, I used to sit up and watch basketball and baseball and football with him and all the games. So from as long as I can remember, I was born in 1959. I remember every playoff time, the Knicks playing this other team called Boston Celtics, and this guy used to just take over the game all the time. And you know, my stepdad, Jimmy, was a sailor. He was in the Navy, and he used to curse like a sailor. And I remember all the curses. Oh, get it. This guy, Bill Russell, was just devastating the Knicks for 10 years, as long as I can remember.
He probably had – so he had a dirty name in front of his – in front of Bill Russell's name, no doubt, huh?
Oh, my God. Yeah. My stepdad was a fan of Willis Reed, and I became a fan of Walt Frazier, right? So
sure.
In 1968, this guy, Bill Russell, retires. But then he comes back, and he becomes the first player coach in history, first African-American player coach in history, and won again, beat the Knicks, right? I'm like, oh, man. So he retires. 1969 was the first year the Knicks won the championship, along with Willis Reed and Walt Frazier, David DeBuscher, Bill Bradley, and it was a great time. Not only that, but he had this guy, Joe Willie Namath, right, for the New York Jets win in 1969. And then in baseball, we had the Miracle Mets with Tommy Seaver and Don Clendenin.
Oh, man, Tommy Seaver, you're taking me back, man. I was a Dodgers fan back then, and I can still, I don't follow baseball much, but I can still tell you, you know, it was the first base. I can just tell you exactly who it was in my time when the Dodgers were the Kings. I was a big Dodgers fan.
Yeah. Tug McGraw. I remember the pitchers, man. They were devastating.
I've been spending time with Tim McGraw for a lot of years. Like I said, I did country, so Tug's son Tim is a big country star, you know.
Did not know that at all.
One of the biggest in the format. So Tim and Faith Hill, if you ever see Tim McGraw, you know that's Tug's son. Yeah, so there you go.
Right.
I taught you something today, KB. So basketball, just give me a sentence. What pops to mind when I name a single? Basketball.
Basketball. I mean, the first line, basketball is my favorite sport. I like the way they dribble up and down the court.
I love it. You know the part I love about that song? Yeah. Tell me, were you in the joint?
Tonight, we'll score 100 points. Yeah.
Your voice, man. And Chuck details a lot about how he wanted to be a sports announcer and how he got that tonality in his voice that he was mimicking a sportscaster. And, you know, you can go back and sort of hear in his deliveries of the early PE that he was doing that, those tricks with his voice. You did it a lot. You did a lot of getting deep in that half step in the rap.
Right.
Christmas rapping. What does that mean to you? One sentence explains Christmas rapping.
My favorite song by Kurtis Blow.
That's your favorite?
Yes, sir.
My favorite is 8 Million Stories. Tupac's Brenda's Got a Baby didn't come out until the early 90s, but I'm sorry, Kurtis and Run DMC told that story way before Tupac did. That was a heavy, heavy part of that song at that time. Now you listen to it, and it just isn't, it's just another lyric in another song, because every end of hip hop has been reached with sex and dirty words and whatever. But
there are 8 million stories in a naked city. Mean streets and the ghetto cultures, the pimps, the pushers, the shops, the vultures, the thugs.
A young girl seen her be gaining weight. Her parents all thought it was the food she ate. The attitudes were all la-di-da-di. But little did they know there was a baby in the body. She tried to hide it, but they'll soon know. Cause sooner or later, the baby's gotta show. Can a daddy just accept that as a fact that it wasn't the meals and it wasn't snacks?
Then there's another girl, her name is Vicky. The girl is five, but sure enough tricky. But then she's not very kind. She'll lay you down and then she'll rob you blind. You wake up in the morning and you're feeling blue, because Vicky is gone and your money is too. She's more sinister than Peter Lorre, and this is just 2 of 8 million stories.
Yeah, well, you know, it all goes back to my days in college and being a speech communications major, and I made the analogy that raps are like speeches, and you have your intro, your body, your conclusion. You have your different kinds of text that you put in the speech, what kind of a speech, like an informative, a demonstrative speech is one that, you know, is informative, gives out information, and teaches, gives you instruction, like basketball or Christmas. Then you have political speeches, you know, 8 Million Stories Social. You have inspirational raps, you know, inspirational speeches like pep rallies, you know, party time, let's have a good time. Yeah, here's one, a good one for you. An extemporaneous speech is one that's not written. It's off the cuff. That's what we call a freestyle, correct?
Yes, sir.
So it's off the top of the head. So those categories became the basis of my first 5 albums. And that's where you get the text. The text of taking it to the next level. Even after the breaks, we released the real first message rap, which was a song called Throughout Your Years. It's an inspirational rap. It's the first gospel rap. Oh, it's incredible. The first message rap, 2 years before the message.
Throughout your years, your ups and downs, your highs and your lows. I'm the man with the mic who rocks the house, the man called Kurtis Blow. So get out your seat, grab the girl, because I'm about ready to rock the world. And listen to my story, because I got to be told like an Oscar and an actor when you're playing a role. When I went to bed, there was something in my head. Be a rapper was my dream. Like in the morning with the bacon and the eggs and the coffee and the cream. So I made up my mind that I would always try to be the best that I could be. Now here I am rapping at the jam with the whole fly guys and a young lady. Just take your time, you don't have to hurry. You don't have to worry, it's society, the strong survive. So rap, sing, get a 9 to 5. With a little hard work and dedication, we'll pull together and rock the nation. So if you do the do and you think you're great, come on everybody, participate. Say ho!
Ow.
You got to say ho if you're ready to go. Say ow!
Ow.
You got to say ow if you're ready right now. Say pride!
Pride!
Cause pride is what we got inside.
You talk a lot about being religious. But you were a ladies lover, Kurtis, a ladies lover.
Yeah.
How did you get sprung on the ladies?
It's either being into ladies and or being into men.
Well, no, okay, but I mean, you one of the first sex symbols of hip hop, if not the first, aren't you?
So you know my choice.
I knew your choice, Kurt. I'm saying, was there a teenage, did you have you a babysitter or somebody?
No.
Somebody said get set you off on the path. Maybe that's a better question for the Egyptian lover, because that guy.
Right, right.
He a one-track
exactly.
Mind, right?
Yeah. I've always loved the ladies. I mean, you know, I'm a lover, not a fire. But meeting Blondie was really, really cool. And she flew me out to England in 1980, and I was like infatuated with her. And so after meeting her, we didn't hit it off too cool.
How come?
She didn't like me.
Why? Was you a dog, Kurtis, or what?
No. I was too short. That's what it was. I was too short.
How tall are you? Are you a little guy?
And I didn't have. Yeah, I'm about 5'8".
I'm 5'8". You are a shorter giant. That's why you like basketball,
yeah.
Huh?
I could never, you know, I could dribble, man. You can't check me, but slamming, dunking, and all of that. That's why, you know, Dr. J, my man.
So Debbie Harry, here's what I didn't know. I talked with Cosmo from the Nucleus, and I asked him who his favorite artists were. He couldn't come up with a favorite rap song. I asked him who his favorite electronic music was, because he was an electronic music producer in effect at that time. And he told me Giorgio Moroder. And then I go and I dig up some of that Giorgio Moroder, and I find out that that's the base of Blondie's song. I didn't know that.
Oh, big shout out to Debbie Harry, man. People don't give her props, but she has the factual first number one pop
rap song on the pop charts. Don't get it twisted. It's Rapture in 1981.
Don't get it twisted. I hear that Lonzo brought you out, and he said that Davey D came along at that particular point, and they were still doing the biting rhymes. And after they brought Davey DMX, Davey DMX's scratch was the beginning or the jump off for DJs using the crossfader, and that you guys actually set up the turntables there to teach Dr. Dre how to do it. He didn't know how to do it, and DMX and you guys were there when that happened. Tell me about that.
It was really an incredible time for me, you know, just traveling outside of New York for the first time and going to all these places, incredible places, you know, Atlanta and Chicago, and oh my gosh, I went to Hollywood, California, and ended up on Highland Avenue and Hollywood Boulevard to the Holiday Inn there. That was the hot spot. Everybody who flew into L.A. went to the Holiday Inn on Highland Avenue, and I was there, and I played this club down in the hood somewhere. It was packed out of the kazoo. And so they asked me to do, you know, there was no dressing room. It was so packed. There was no dressing room, no area to dress. I was like, well, I need to change. I need to get dressed. What's going on? So he took me back in his office. Alonzo Williams took me back to his office, and we sat back there and chilled. And it was like, I was like really, really, you know, impressed and happy that, you know, he opened up his office and made it happen anyway for us, right? And so he was a nice guy. And so we set up the turntables and sound check and got everything ready. And Dave was just scratching, and Alonzo was like, yo, what are you doing? That's incredible. And he brought in Yellow.
Yeah.
And Dave gave him an exhibition about, you know, DJing and scratching and how you go from one turntable to another very fast.
You changed the world, Kurtis, on that day. You changed the world to a West Coast little B-boy's life.
Well, actually, it was Davey D, because he actually didn't have to do that. But he was such a nice guy, you know. And we were so happy just to travel and represent hip-hop, you know. Of course, we showed everybody what we did and how to hold the microphone and how to cut. And, you know, we were happy to do that, you know, just spread the love. And little did we know that Yellow went back and talked Dre, and Dre talked, I mean, they started the Uncle Jam's Army, you know, the World Class Wrecking Crew, and everybody else started following them.
Right.
You know, so they taught the whole West Coast what we taught them. So that was just an incredible thing. And you never know. That's why they always say, when you're traveling and you are blessed and fortunate enough to be out in the public and get on stage, you know, yeah, man, be kind, you know. And that combats that story about New Edition and how I was a hater with New Edition. How about that?
Were you?
That's what they say.
Why the New Edition of all people? Doesn't even seem like the same wheelhouse. I mean, all of that music was in the same wheelhouse back then. We hadn't broken it off into genres yet. So, but why you?
Well, you see, I'll tell you why. Because, see, I met New Edition. I think they're kind of upset at me a little bit. But at first, when I first met them, I went up to Boston. I played Boston. They opened up the show. And New Kids on the Block went on second. These are the two winners of the contest that they had up there. They told me the story that they opened up for me. I had forgot. So I was nice to them, right? And then they got a record deal and became famous. And so when they started out, they were different. They were, you know, young kids, man. Young kids. And all I did was inspire them and treat them good and was never a hater. Now, when they got older, to be 17, 18, 19, was when they really got beside themselves and wanted to headline over everybody. So I let them headline over me one day and tore them up. the live show business is totally different from the recording.
Oh yeah,
business.
For sure.
A group can sound great in the studio and make records and sound great, but get out there on a live stage and suck.
That's just the fact right there. That's you just said
right.
It's just like that.
Now, I'm going to name some groups who are incredible on stage. R&B groups, because I love R&B, I love hip-hop, everything. But, you know, Kool & the Gang, great on stage. Earth, Wind & Fire, great on stage. You've seen Charlie Wilson lately. Great on stage.
Yep.
That's what I'm talking about. That kind of caliber of a show where you have a band. If you're R&B, you know, come on. Man, listen, Cameo would tear Kurtis Blow up. There's not many groups that can do that. Stephanie Mills, incredible live performer on stage. She blew me away. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But that's about it. Now, New Edition is not even in the group, in the category. I'm not a hater. I'm just trying to give you the facts from what I've seen and what I remember. People used to complain about them. I mean, they were young and cute and they used to dance and this and that, but, you know, live show, it was to tracks, an R&B group to tracks. If you're not breakdancing and saying ho and everybody scream, you're not Stephanie Mills
hey.
In a band and blowing at the top of, you know what I mean? It's a different, totally, totally different.
If I was an artist, I don't know if I ever want to hear that, Kay. But you know what? Well, you good,
exactly.
but you ain't no Stephanie Mills.
No, I'm not. I'm saying Stephanie is incredible.
Right.
Okay.
I got you.
So the reputation, your reputation goes around, and everybody knows. So I mean, and they were the young group coming up, kids. Everyone used to take care of them and treat them, you know, like their younger brothers and love on them. But they had problems, a lot of problems with everybody, and they didn't put this in the movie. These are facts of the history from what I can tell you, and I can get many people to corroborate this story. And so the problems I had with them were when I had five albums and they had one number one hit song, they wanted to go on after me.
Yeah.
All right, so I let them, and I tore them up.
Right.
And that was that.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, but here's the deal. I got the opportunity to do Crush Groove in 1985.
Crush grooving, body moving. Crush grooving, body moving.
Thank you for that, Kurtis. Thank you.
I'm in high school for that, man.
Now we're b-boying, and I'm in high school when all these come out. So thank you for that.
So here's the story. So I always loved New Edition from the 80s, the early 80s, until they wanted to go on after me. But that's cool. No problem. You can go on after me now, whenever. So I got them in the movie.
Yeah.
And
Stevie D. Lundy told me that. I heard Stevie D. from the 4 Soon D's tell me the story about that. He was on the Rewind. He told me all about that. Tell me your version. How did it go down?
Right. So I got them the role in the movie, but I didn't know that the producers and the writers were going to write the story that they wrote, which was the Fat Boys won the contest at Radio City. True story, but New Edition wasn't in the contest. But in the movie, in the contest, New Edition lost to the Fat Boys.
Schiller and us will keep moving and grooving like the number 10 bus.
And I know they felt some kind of way because I knew that they were good and they were better than that. And they might have won. Who knows? The real contest if they were there. I guess they felt that they might have won. But, you know, I guess they felt some kind of way that they were portrayed like that in the movie that the Fat Boys won. So it might have been payback from that. You know what I mean?
Sure.
But other than that, you know, there's some drug stories there, too. There's some homosexual stories, too, there, too, that nobody ever talks about. But I'm not going to start talking about it now because, you know, what I really want to do is say that I love them and they've been through a lot. And no hard feelings about how I was portrayed. I'm sorry they thought I was that kind of a guy. But I know I'm not that kind of a guy now. And I love God and, you know, the best for them. The best for them.
I thought Run DMC's Hard Times was Run DMC's Hard Times. Kurtis, tell me about Hard Times.
Well, Hard Times actually was a song I did in 1981.
Had no idea.
Hard times spreading just like the flu. You know I caught it just like you. Price is going up, the dollar's down. You got me falling to the ground. Turn around, get ready, check out the clock. Get ready, all people, for the future shock. Hard times.
Hard times.
Hard times.
Hard times.
To the bridge.
It was a song that I really know you don't know this. I did something called beatbox on this song in 1981, a few years before Dougie Fresh.
Count it, bro.
And I got it from Al Jarreau. You remember Al Jarreau?
Absolutely.
He used to make instrument sounds with his voice.
Sure.
And so I wanted to do that. The producers actually had the idea, J.B. Moore. Yeah, we want to do you do a drum and then do a conga and then do a timbali. And then I did that and the drummer repeated it and stuff like that. So later on,
a timbali. You mean a like a drum, but a mid to high sound. Hey, I learned that in this podcast, man. I'm going to use it again right now, Kurtis. You told me now. Now I'm dangerous with the timbali. I'm dangerous with it now. Shouldn't have told me about it.
Yeah. There you go. Hey, just listen to the breaks.
Yep.
The end of the breaks is 3 minutes of timbali that can't be beat. Incredible timbali.
I mentioned 8 Million Stories. AJ Scratch, rest in peace. Tell me about that song, AJ. AJ Scratch, the flip side of 8 Million Stories.
1, 2, 3, 4,
up in the booth with the people of Fresh. There was one DJ who had to pass the test. They know he's down below and he's ready to play. That's right, y'all, his name is AJ. Never gets nervous when he cuts the beat. He gives top-notch service in the clutch on the street. A complete elite team that can't be beat. Cause AJ never knew the agony of the beat. Sing!
AJ!
Well, truth of the story is AJ was sitting on a plane with me. We were on our way to Europe to go on tour in 1983. And so he was depressed. He was depressed about this girl, Nadine Rose.
Nadine, let's get her up on Facebook. What's she look like? I'm going to punch that.
Nadine with an N, like baby. Yeah. Nadine Rose from the Bronx.
A heartbreaker.
Right. She didn't want to give him the time of day.
Oh.
I said, what? I said, what, Jay? I said, I'll tell you what. I'm
going to
make you a record. And I'm going to make you a big star. And I've I'll bet you she'll give you the time of day then. He said, yeah, yeah. So we got back home from the tour, went into the studio, and I wrote the song, 100% of the song. Boom. That was one of my few 100% ownership songs.
Mm-hmm.
And so, man, we put the song out. And actually, we put the song out on the B side of 8 Million Stories.
Right.
8 Million Stories.
That's how I know about it.
Right?
Yeah.
8 Million Stories was the first single. And Chuck Leonard, rest in peace, I remember him, Kiss 98.7 Kiss, he played it first. Boom. 8 Million Stories from Kurtis Blow. Broke the record. But then AJ, the song AJ came out. And boom, destroyed the B-side of the record, was hotter than the A-side. That was a miracle.
How did Nadine feel about that? Did we find out?
So AJ was a big star.
Yeah.
All up in the, everybody was saying, AJ. So Nadine Rose gave him the time of day. He took her out to dinner. And she became his girlfriend until we went out on tour the next year and he met this German girl, a rich German girl. Oh my God. I forgot about Nadine Rose.
Nadine, you didn't forget about that much. Nadine Rose. You got that name there.
Miss Rose. That's his name. That's his name for her. Miss Rose.
Miss Rose.
Miss Rose. Yeah.
If I Ruled the World, is that your biggest moneymaker now? What's the song that makes you the most money right now, Kurtis?
I don't know about money, but If I Rule the World was a big, huge hurrah for me.
If I rule the world, I love all the girls, wear diamonds and pearls. If I rule the world.
Because there was so much competition around, and, you know, the movie Crush Groove, when the movie Crush Groove, I'm producing the soundtrack, and everybody hears my little song, It's I Rule the World, so let me see.
If I rule the world, world, king of the throne, I make peace in every coach, build a home, it's a home, not running, a comics or the birth of death, I'm just here to tell the world how my story went. You see, first it was a dream, I was living in Rome, and then I moved to London, bought a brand new home, and everywhere I went, I drew lots of attention like a stress limousine. One of those new inventions. It took a few years before the day had come, but I was ruler of the world, rank number one. So I headed for Washington to claim the crown, let the whole world know that the king was in town.
You know, they come out with this, I'm the king of rock. I'm like, why you guys gotta be the king now? You know I'm coming.
You're the son of Kurtis Blow. How can you be the king of rock now?
Oh, wow. Hurt me. Broke my heart. I was like, wow, they put the song, it peaked at 44 on the charts. 44 on the R&B charts. My song was already done. My song was the first single. Let me tell you about this. I'm with PolyGram. PolyGram knows I'm producing the soundtrack. So Warner Brothers has the soundtrack. So Warner Brothers hears If I Rule the World. The demo. Oh, my God. So they come to me, the president. No, Benny Ashburn. Benny says, look, I will promise you, I'll give you in writing, if you give us the 7-inch, keep the 12-inch, keep the album verse, give us the 7-inch single, tell your record company, the president, tell him, if you give us a 7-inch, we will guarantee you a number one pop hit. We guarantee it. This is what Warner Brothers said to me. So I went back to my president, Dick Asher. I told him, Warner Brothers said, if we get on the single, they're going to give us a number one pop song. I'll be first to get the pop song for hip hop. This is before Walk This Way, too.
Right.
And so Dick Asher says, Kurtis, tell him, I said, no. You tell him, you are our artist. Oh, so.
Is that the sound of deflation? Oh.
yo, look, they broke me. I was a broken artist after that. The song peaked at number 15 on the R&B chart. It did better than King of Rock. It sold more. Yes, it was a big hit. But it could have been number one pop. So I was a broken artist after that. That was the beginning of the downfall. I gave up. I didn't have the support and respect of my record company. I understood it was business, but you guys turned around and didn't deliver a number one record.
How many years had you been on the label at that point?
That was 1985. I had a brand new deal with them to produce myself for 5 albums. Became the first millionaire in hip-hop with that record deal. And that was 85. Crush Groove, 86.
The question you get asked, what question am I going to ask you right now about Crush Groove? You already know the next question about Crush Groove that I'm going to ask you. What is it? Come on, Kurtis.
Sheila E.
Yeah, man. Come on. Did anybody hit it? Who pushed up on Sheila E.? You put it off on Charlie Stetler on Sway's interview. He ain't there for you now, so you gotta give up, man. Tell me about Sheila E.
I was secretly in love with Sheila E., and I wanted to play Blair Underwood's role.
Oh, I bet that you was did. My role. I bet he you. We all wanted to play Blair Underwood's role.
Right. He beat me out of that role. But I was still secretly in love with her. But we all were scared. We were scared of Prince. Prince was coming on the set, hanging out on the set. And we would dare not touch Prince, girl.
He's 4 feet tall, man. Come on, Kurt.
Man, we love Prince, man. That guy was like, that was like the next thing to Michael Jackson.
You know what? Now that it's all said and done, is Prince the king of pop and not Michael Jackson after it's all said and done? My definition might have changed since Prince died.
God.
Because count the number of singles that Michael had. I understand that he had influence, but let's really dig into Prince's classic to the B-sides and the greatest hits.
Oh my
and I
God.
Don't think anybody touches him. I just don't think anybody touches him. I think he was.
Why you wanna go there?
I'm just saying.
We could talk hours about that.
I'm
one right
just
there, man.
Saying, man. Prince, in retrospect,
he was incredible. I mean, you know, for what it's worth, Prince has his unbeatable qualities, like musician, incredible. He was Jimmy Castor. You know, Jimmy Castor was known as the everything man. He played every instrument, and so did Prince, right?
Right.
But Prince, I don't know. Michael was a better dancer, but Prince was a good dancer too.
I just go back and do sheer number count at this point, and if it's on if it's on the numbers, Prince wins. And that's bad. I mean, because I'm Michael.
What about those Jackson 5 hits? Are you kidding me?
Well, okay, throw them in. There's another 3 or 4, but, you know, seriously.
3 or 4?
How many Jackson 5 hits were there?
I mean, I Want You Back.
Yeah. ABC.
Mom, ABC.
Yeah.
Mama's Pearl.
Okay. That's 3.
It's just... what's the sugar daddy?
Okay,
and
4.
The ballast. Come on,
I'm just
the ballast. Never sang, you never can.
I'm not being sacrilegious to the format. I'm just saying. In death, man, Prince was damn close to being the king of pop. I know why Michael is.
Maybe
because
the best ballad ever is Who Love in you.
Yeah.
Who's loving? Why? Come on now.
Call it 5, man.
That might be the best.
I'm not taking
ever.
Nothing from Michael Jackson. I just think some stuff might have been taken away from Prince as far as sheer numbers. That's all. I watched Motown 25. I was.
Who's
16.
The better singer? How
oh, Michael
that
Jackson.
One?
Michael Jackson by far. Let's call that. That's easy.
But you know what, Prince, I had a great time with Prince. I owe him. He actually, you know, my biggest production I ever did was this Martin Luther King, King Holiday song.
Oh, I was just getting ready to get to that. That was one of my favorite songs
right?
ever cut, man. I mean,
Prince, Prince actually paid for the video. And he paid $90,000 for that video.
He's not even in it.
He's not even in it. He didn't have anything to do with the songwriting. It was just the meaningfulness of the video needed to be done. You know, that was Dexter Scott King, his son.
New Edition's in that. So, little beef there, but you had New Edition in King Holiday, yep. Didn't you?
And Menudo, Ricky Martin.
And Ricky Martin. Yes, absolutely. That's one of my faves. That there is one of my favorite 12, not only is one of my favorite 12-inch covers, that's one of my favorite songs ever in hip-hop. Just, that's the We Are the World of hip-hop. I mean.
Right. Exactly.
It wasn't Sun City. I couldn't get with Sun City.
There you go. You know about Sun City.
I'm a bit of a historian, but I'm from the coast and I could only get what we were privy to.
My good friend, man. Lil Stevie. Big shout out to Lil Stevie, man. That's a good dude, man. He actually, I helped him. You know, and he got upset with me, and I owe him one. I'm so sorry, because he wanted to be on the King Holiday song. So I asked him, did you help me with my song? You didn't even call me for yours.
Hey, didn't he make We Are the World? No.
Yes.
Yeah, he's in We Are the World, right? Crush Groovin', what's the funniest thing that happened on set? You recall anything really funny that happened on set? Who was the biggest player around there? Was it you? Was anybody joking? Were you the hard ass? Who was the comic of the crew?
Funniest thing to me was Russell Simmons playing his role. I mean, we all didn't know how to act. No, none of us were actors.
You've got hip hop in the room. What do you do with it?
Right, right. So we all were coached by Gloria Schultz, who was the director, Michael Schultz, his wife. And she taught us how to act on the set. But I don't think she did anything with Russell. But he came off with his role as such a natural that we all were rolling on the full floor because he didn't have any lines, and his lines were just, you know, straight impromptu and extemporaneous. Again, there we go. So he was a natural, incredible, incredible scene. And we all were rolling, like laughing so hard because he was like approaching Blair Underwood trying to get Run DMC on stage. So here's a guy playing a promoter. Russell Simmons is playing a promoter asking Russell Simmons in the movie to get your group on stage. And so he's like, hey, partner.
Hey, partner,
let me just holler at you for a second over here, man. You got to do something with these boys. You got to get these boys on stage, Jack. You know, so we was like, where did you get that from? Who is that partner?
Is Crush Groove your favorite hip-hop movie?
Oh, wow. That's a good question. That's a loaded question, guy.
I didn't ask it as a loaded question, I'll tell you that.
I actually like, you know, I talked to Charlie Ahern yesterday, and that's a good guy, man. And I really like the authenticity of Wild Style.
Right.
The fact that, you know, you got so many of the players from the Bronx got their day to shine. Really, really good. And I actually like the story of Beat Street, you know, right. Ramon, and it was really, really heartfelt. And the fact that Harry Belafonte, I mean, I actually auditioned for him and sang my song Daydreaming, thinking that he would go with this R&B sound, and he was like, we're looking for a rapper. I didn't make it. I was brokenhearted. And then God blessed us with Crush Groove, so I'm not too bad now. But those, I like all of them. All those three movies are incredible.
Is there something I haven't asked you yet about, say, the hip-hop museum or the hip-hop church or something new that you've got coming up? Because I'm aware that you got your hands in all of that stuff. So a couple of the interviews I saw was prior to to one of them being open, I believe, and the museum is now open. Is that correct?
No. We landed the building. We won the bid on the building with a corporation.
So you're still there,
named
okay.
L&M out of the Bronx. We'll be up at the location. We'll be at the Bronx Point, they call it, right across the 145th Street Bridge in Harlem. Once you go across the bridge, it's 149th Street in the Bronx, and that's the southern tip of Yankee Stadium. So it's prime beef right there, prime real estate.
The frame shop, Google, still involved?
Yes.
Which is like virtual reality. This thing's going to be sweet when it gets done. Where are we in the process?
We're just getting the shell together. So we're raising the capital right now. We have some commitments from the Bronx Borough President's Office and the Mayor's Office. And Leo Cohen is helping out. You know, we've been talking to Leo Cohen.
Yep.
Yeah, Lyra.
Jam. Yep.
And then, you know, been working with Wyclef John and LL Cool J and Ice-T.
But that boy's got enough money. How much does it cost?
It's going to cost about $90 million.
Come on, man. These mumble rappers. Hey, have one of these mumbling rappers put up some of their money, man.
I got 80, so if you just get 10, we'll be good.
Just come up with it. That's a funny one.
I got 80.
You make yourself laugh. I like that, KB.
No, but actually, we've been working with a company called CCS, who is the company that raised the money for the Smithsonian African American Museum down there in D.C. And they raised $330 million for that museum after trying to starting out with the number of $140 million. So we need 90. They said that's a no-brainer, no problem for us. So I think we'll be good in raising the capital. So we're concentrating on the curation right now, getting the artifacts and the old flyers and the pictures and, of course, the technology, working with the virtual stuff. And we're even going to have a huge mobile museum, a big mega truck. Yeah. We call this truck the Megatron. And it's going to be this truck. We're going to open it up. And people can walk inside and get a sample of like a pop-up museum traveling around the country.
I think that story needs to be told. These kids don't know nothing about it.
That's our mission, you know, to tell a true story, true history, give these kids something to study and have a research point. Actually, you know, hands-on is the best thing, too, that we see for the museum, like places where they can DJ, where they can record or do a virtual graffiti art piece and stuff like that. That's also going to be in the mobile museum as well. I got to shout out Rocky Buchano, the director and president who actually is doing all the work, along with Renee Foster and Deidre Tate and Reggie Peters and Ed Young and Dembisa. Nadaba Mandela is a part of our team.
Very cool.
Working on the International Global Hip Hop Organization. You know, Nelson Mandela's grandson. And, you know, so shout out to the team and big ups to everybody sacrificing and working so hard for 4 years now.
Your area code says that you live in Los Angeles. I figured you'd still be in the East Coast. Do you split time or are you a California guy now?
Well, no, I split time, but actually I represent the 818, okay? Don't get that one twisted. We out here in the valley, and it's all good in the neighborhood. I love it. I love the West Coast. I love the weather. It's the best weather in the world, especially in December and January. I mean, you can't beat this anywhere in the world.
Right. You're used to all that. So I went to Denver for like 30 days, and it didn't last. Boy, that tell you what, that cold in me didn't last. This California boy had to come home.
Oh, man.
I resigned. You know, and I'm about an hour east of San Francisco. Are you familiar with Stockton, Modesto? You played at University of Pacific. You played Arm of the Fresh Fest at University of Pacific. I saw you. I think you wore a big white leather suit, if I'm not mistaken. It was Run DMC, Kurtis Blow. I don't know if Nucleus made it or not. Somebody didn't make the tour. And I saw Houdini that night. I saw Kurtis Blow. I can't imagine if it was Nucleus or not. It changed my life.
Fat Boys.
Yeah, no.
Wow.
Maybe the Fat Boys were the ones that weren't there. Did somebody sub for the Fat Boys? Is there somebody that didn't make the tour sometime or maybe missed the West Coast leg? Maybe the Fat Boys.
Flash and them.
Yeah. But I saw that at the University of Pacific in, what do I call it, 84?
Yeah.
85? Changed my life, Kurt.
Yeah.
Ice-T's album changed my life. NWA's album changed my life. But that's what we had out here, you know. I'm a big Grandmaster Flash fan. I like It's a Shame. I like Scorpio, but I like It's a Shame, the track after Scorpio. You know Love all that, man. I just love it. I'm a big old fan. What was a song of Kurtis Blow's that Kurtis Blow loves that didn't make it?
There's one called "I Got to Dance." I got to dance. It should have been a single.
Feeling kind of bad about the day you had. You got to find a way to make it right. And if your body's got the juice and you're feeling kind of loose, you're stepping out and throwing down tonight. There's a million different ways to make it through the days, to get yourself a shot of exercise. But the only way I know to let my body go is dancing till the sun begins to rise. I got to dance.
Another one I did called Still on the Scene. Very nice song. Very witty in the rap. Some really, really good rap skills.
Some of us are by getting too high. Some of us are by going too low. But I'll always stay on top. Ask me why.
Why?
I'm Kurtis Blow and I'm the king on the scene.
Stay on the scene. I'm the king on the scene.
Seen after all these years, like a pioneer, I conquer new frontiers. I'm the king and I'm back, and I sing and I act. I do my thing, I'm not whack.
Is that a fact?
You know it's true. I wouldn't lie to you, and if you won't take my word, give my career a review. I've done shows all over the globe, and when I'm home off tour, I'm maxing my red road. Sit back and watch cable, put my feet on the table, collecting royalty checks from my record label. So you see, I've been around, and I'm still down, and I'll always hold the crown. I'm the king on the scene.
What's the worst Kurtis Blow song?
I think a song called Ego Trip.
You don't dance to my ego, you dance to my beat. So come on, party people, get out your seat.
Dance to my ego, dance to my beat. Dance to my ego, dance to my
beat. I remember that one.
But then, you know, basketball came into my head, too.
Oh, now. Is basketball a moneymaker these days? If you've gotten licensing, maybe video game licensing and stuff?
Derek Fisher just danced at basketball on Dancing with the Stars. And last night, Terrell Owens danced to the breaks.
Oh, huge.
Last night, yes, sir. Terrell Owens.
Wow.
Incredible.
So how does that work? So, does TV have to call you to clear that? How does that work?
Yeah, sometimes they call me. Sometimes they call the publisher. Sometimes they call Harry Fox. They can get a license agreement several different ways.
What's Kurtis Blow's favorite accomplishment as far as recording music? I bet your favorite now is the Hip Hop Church, the museum, the things you're looking forward to. What song makes you the most proud, Kurtis, of your own?
So I think King Holiday. This is my most meaningful song.
I love it, man.
I got the chance to work with Whitney Houston. You know, we also were born on the same day, like Cosmo, right? Yeah. Oh, did you know Cosmo D was born on August 9th? Did he tell you that?
I did not know that. I was not aware of that. That's a day okay. There's a good birthday of hip hop, isn't it?
Yeah, and he also was born on the same day, same year, and in the same borough, the borough of Manhattan. But Whitney is also 1959, August 9th. She's not 59. I think she's 60 or 61, maybe. But in recording her, I remember when she came to the studio, she came in and, she was a huge star during that time. And she got behind the microphone and sang her part and started to ad-lib and hit a note and scream and blew out the speakers. But this note that she sang was so good. And I was like, no, we're keeping it. And the engineers, no, can't you hear it? It's distorted. And I was like, Whitney. She's like, yeah, Kurtis. I said, what do you think? She said, I mean, it's okay. It's all right with me. What do you think, Kurtis? I said, I love it. She said, we're keeping it. She left. Boom, walked out the door. So I kept that, and it is distorted. You can hear it distorted, but it's the best note ever that I've heard. And she had all that power and blew out the speakers. My girl, I love you forever. Whitney Houston.
What would you like to say to everybody, Kurtis, that's listening to the podcast today?
Well, I would like to say, those of you who want to make it in hip-hop, think about this. Research, research, research. Education, education, education is the key to getting out of the ghetto and the key to success. Nowadays, everything is crazy. I just want to shout out families that lost people, families that lost loved ones in Vegas, Las Vegas. Compassion and heartfelt shout out right now to all of those who are suffering right now. And to everyone else, please find God in your life. Whatever you do, now is the time, now more than ever. We need God. We need to go back to a spiritual, religious way of life and get some rules in our lives and stop all this madness, because everything does not go. Come on, guys. Let's get back. Let's get back to the kingdom and the fold and just the way of life where we all can live life more abundantly. All right? I love everybody. I love you guys. Take care.
That's Kurtis Blow on the Old School Rewind. I'm going to close out with a song, Kurtis. What song should I play from Kurtis Blow? I always end the show like that. Tell me which one to end with.
All right, let's end with Party Time.
Party Time on the Old School Rewind. Kurtis Blow, I appreciate you. Thank you for making time today, bud.
All right, thank you, too. Thank you. God bless.
Party time, oh, it's party time. We're living the party. brand new sound sensation. It's gonna be a revelation. Gonna show you what I mean. They call it the EU freeze. Play it pretty as please. Beating on the drum keys. Rocking on the go-go scene. Yeah.
This is the Old School Rewind. Share and subscribe now at oldschoolrewind.com, facebook.com/oldschoolrewind, and at oldschoolrewind.com.